Jesus says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. But how do you love someone who murdered your daughter? Stay tuned as our guest shares her story. This is Time Out. I'm Patty Sandifer, and today I want to welcome back our guest from last week, and that is Diane Harper. Thanks for being back with us.
Thank you for having me.
We want to hear the rest of the story.
Okay.
It's a tragic story. First of all, before we get into that, I just want you to tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm currently an apartment manager in Denver, Colorado, and I have a ministry called Sunlight Services. I took a six-year evangelism training course through Natty Institute, which is the same evangelistic training that seminary students get at Andrews University.
Okay.
And I've become involved. I took domestic violence advocacy training and am very interested in
mediation,
psychology and mediation. I've taken mediation training.
Okay. And as we get into your story, people, our viewers, you will understand more why these areas have an interest for her. So we have viewers who weren't with us maybe last week. Could you just recap a little bit of the story of your daughter, Heather?
Sure. In 1991, my oldest daughter, Heather, was murdered. She was 16 at the time. And God... I reacted like a typical parent. The grief was intensive, but God just had, he first of all gave me absolute assurance about Heather's salvation through intercessory prayer, people who had called, and then he brought many of her friends to himself. We had a year of amazing miracles that God not only saved Heather, but he also saved many of her friends.
And you had that reassurance from things that she had done, like the tape that she had made that you talked about last week, a little tape that she had made as a little girl with songs and different ones that she would dedicate to each family member.
Holy Spirit led her many years. The Holy Spirit knows exactly what's going to happen in our lives. And he led her many years to make some comforting tapes for us that led to a person's conversion after she was killed.
Yeah, that's great. Now, where do we go from here? Because we start out with a horrific tragedy, the loss of a child, something that, you know, I can't even imagine. Most of us can't and don't want to. And now you're thrown into all of the things that she's had. You've had the funeral service, and now you're out in the living aspects and the stuff that comes after that.
Yes.
So tell us about that, the journey beyond here.
Well, the justice side of it started, the offender was arrested a day and a half after Heather was killed.
Okay.
And he was arrested in Vancouver. Mm-hmm. So we had an extradition to go through. We thought there were three eyewitnesses to her murder, and all three of them were kind of shaky. And there, we never found the knife. We did not have some of the hard evidence that you need. And so it can, the DA told me that it could take up to 90 days to get an extradition done. We were concerned about some of the eyewitnesses disappearing, but it just took me calling Oregon and Washington governors and attorney general's offices, and we got the, and this is as a result of prayer, I believe, we got the extradition done in 30 days.
Wow.
And then when he was in, having to go into the courtroom with him was unbelievable. So he was arrested in September, but there are countless hearings that you have to go through. The worst experience was in January of '92 when, for the first time, I heard the eyewitness testimonies. Mm. And they're listening in graphic detail what had happened to my daughter. Mm. And
someone looking, you protected your whole life.
Yes.
And loved. And
yes. And to have that person in the room with me who had taken away my girl, mm-hmm. and to listen to what he did to her, mm-hmm. was unbelievable.
And it's still the painful rage, to this day, yeah.
It will never go away.
No.
No. Your children, how I am now, God has enabled me to bear the pain.
Yes.
And we're 18 years down the road.
Right.
But she's still my little girl who has missed out on her brother having children, mm-hmm. and missed out on all of the events that, yeah. we're just going to have to play catch up a little bit later on. Mm-hmm. But having to be in the courtroom with the offender, the rage is overwhelming. It's just unbelievable. And so we were pressing to get the death penalty. Mm-hmm. But in Oregon, you have to, it has to be aggravated murder, mm-hmm. which means there has to be another crime committed in the process. Mm-hmm. And so we were trying to prove that he had been trying to lead, you know, get Heather involved in another type of crime, but mm-hmm. the elements were not there. And mm-hmm. so we found in March that we were going to have to go for a life sentence. And so right after the Attorney General called, the DA called me and mm-hmm. said, well, we're going to have to change what we're going for here. It was very disappointing to me. I had looked up all of the Old Testament verses about an eye for an eye, a tooth mm-hmm. for a tooth, mm-hmm. and I remember feeling very confident that that was exactly what we needed to do. I didn't feel bad about it. Ridding the world of evil is what God's plan would certainly be. That was, I told,
justify the hate.
It, mm-hmm. Yes, to mm-hmm. justify the hate. Mm-hmm. I knew that that's what mm-hmm. what God would want us to do. And so when we found out that we couldn't get it, then someone called me anonymously and identified himself. This was about 2 days later, identified himself as a friend of Heather's and said that another friend of theirs was in the Justice Center and they wanted to know if I wanted to have him taken care of. Mm. Well, I knew what they were asking, but I said, well, call me back in a couple of days. I have to think about it. Mm. And so I remember thinking about it for a little bit, but not very long. It was by that night, I knew that when they called back, I was going to say yes. So in my heart, I actually became a premeditated murderer. Mm. And I don't remember feeling guilty about that at all. But God had something else in mind. Mm. A couple days after that decision, a friend of mine that I had met in a grief recovery group, whose daughter had also been murdered, mm-hmm. came over to the house one day, and after he kind of hem-hawed around a little bit, he said, well, the reason I've come over here today is because I think that I need to talk to you about praying about arriving at some level of forgiveness, mm-hmm. because this is not what God would want for you. Mm-hmm. And I said, you what? You think what? That God
doesn't want
that God would want me to forgive him? I couldn't believe that he was suggesting such a thing. Mm-hmm. We had kind of like a mild argument for about half an hour, and where I really resisted it. But I said, okay. At the end of that, I said, all I can promise you is that I'll pray about it in the morning. And I mm-hmm. had a habit of having my morning devotions in the morning mm-hmm. before the kids would get up. And so
you can be a Christian and still have these feelings, huh?
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Oh, you can be a Christian and have overwhelming, horrible feelings. Mm-hmm. And we can find verses in the Bible to justify it, too,
when we
if
want
that's
to.
What we want to do. Right. And that's exactly what I did. But I got up in the morning and randomly opened up my Bible. That's not a thing that I normally do. I'm really a studier, and mm-hmm. I like to study with many versions mm-hmm. to make sure that I'm doing it accurately. Mm-hmm. But I was in such a world of hurt. I was just pleading with God, okay, God, lead me to the right verse for, mm-hmm. for today. So I opened up my Bible, and it just fell open to one of those forgiveness verses. Mm. And I don't know which one was the first one, but I opened it, read it. There it was, love your enemies. I slammed my Bible down. got up, and that was going to be the end of my devotion, started to walk away. And as I was walking away, I got a mental picture of Jesus on the cross, and it was unbelievably impacting. All I could see was, I remember it was like I was looking up at him, and there was a lot of blood and gore, and tears were streaming down his face, but he was looking up into the sky, just shaking his head and saying, "Father, forgive them. They just don't know what they're doing." Mm. And I could sense a horrible emotional pain just reeking off of him, and it was heartbreaking. It was terrible. But I resisted it and walked away. That same thing happened for 4 or 5 days in a row. I would get up, go to my couch, open up my Bible. There's a different forgiveness verse. I tried to walk away, and I got that vision. I knew at the end of that time that it was totally what God wanted me to do. I knew it was way beyond anything that I could do. I didn't want to, but thankfully, being raised where I believe that obedience is important, I knew God had given me assurance of Heather's salvation, and if I walked away from what the Holy Spirit wanted me to do, that was a salvation issue. And I honestly believed that I would have been lost.
I want to be there.
Yeah, I believed I would be lost if I walked away. So in my desperation, I knew that it was way beyond
anything.
Time
to listen.
Yeah, and I couldn't do it. I absolutely couldn't do it. And so the verse in Psalms 51:10 came to my mind, in Ezekiel 36:26, where God says that he will give us a new heart and put a new spirit within us.
Create a new heart, yes.
In that moment, I cried out to God, and I said, "God, I don't know how you're going to do this, but here's a heart for you." I don't know how you're going to pull this off. And so that was a huge point for me. And at that point, I started claiming that promise and praying for the offender, that something would happen in his heart, that he would feel some remorse, because he had never even shown any remorse at that point. So I started praying for him. And then Good Friday that year, he was convicted. He waived his right to a trial, and he was convicted on the eyewitness testimony, and sentencing was set for June. And during that time, during all those first several months, my son, who was 9 at the time, had mentioned to me that he couldn't believe that he had done it. And there were some things, of course, in the court that I wouldn't allow the kids. They were 7 and 9. It was just way too intense for them. I wouldn't allow them to come in here. So he was in denial, and I had said something to the DA about it. And the DA had gotten a court order from the judge to have a special visit with the offender and us. And so I had no idea what an unusual thing it was to have something like that. But since I found that it's actually illegal in Oregon to have a victim offender be, like, go down to the jail, be in the same room at the same time just because of the obvious security risks. But going down to the courtroom that day, as I got out and the DA met us and I asked him if I needed my ID to get in, he said, "No, everyone's expecting you. This is a specially set up visit." We checked into it, and no one's ever heard of anything like this being done in the judicial system. And so I knew that God was really working out something there. And so I just prayed that he would give me the right emotions. I did not know what I was going to do at that point. I had been praying for 2 months that God would give me a right heart and a right spirit. But I still was completely consumed with hatred and rage. It had not been removed. I didn't just one day claim the promise and then it was gone. I was consumed with it. But I was trying to step out and claim the promise just in faith that God would do something. And so going into the Justice Center that day, it wasn't until I actually walked through the last metal detectors that the Holy Spirit did something. I think of it like a recreation. Just in an instant, in a moment, all of that overwhelming chaos and rage and everything that I felt was instantly taken away, and I had this incredible sense of peace. And I looked at him. He was sitting at the other end of the room you know, in shackles, and the DA and head of security and his attorney were all over on one side. And instead of this horrible, vile monster that I had been looking at for months, suddenly I saw this person, and it was like I could just sense a horrible emotional pain coming off from him. Something happened in that moment. The Holy Spirit was there, so that my feelings were completely changed, and so were his. He was responsive to it too. And it was very awkward at first, so I walked up, and I had a sense of wanting to be closer to where he was sitting. There was a table that was supposed to be separating us, and I asked if the table could be removed, and so they took it away. And I said, well, I'm not sure what I should even call you or how we should start this visit today, but I guess the first thing we should talk about is, what should I call you? He had been going by an alias. He was somebody who had been to our house. He wasn't a total stranger. And so we had known him by an alias name and found out later what his real name was. And so I asked him what he wanted to be called and what he was more comfortable with. And he looked at me with like a shocked look on his face, and he said, you don't owe me any courtesy. And I said, yes, I do. I want to know what you're comfortable with. And this is why I'm coming here to talk to you today, is you're a person that God loves just like he loves me. And there's no difference, and I'm experiencing a miracle in my life, and that's why I wanted to come and talk to you today. And so we talked a little bit, and when I felt comfortable, then I allowed the two kids to come in. And it took Justin quite a bit of prompting. At first, he was really hesitant and just kind of looking down, and this is a 9-year-old boy. And I knew it was probably his only chance to try to find some resolve here. And so I said, I really think, you know, Justin, if isn't there something that you'd like to say? And finally he got up his courage and he looked him straight in the eyes and he said, did you murder my sister? And tears started streaming down the offender's eyes. And he said, yes, I did. And I'm so sorry. And he completely broke down in that moment. And I had never seen any remorse at all. And so that was the beginning of our healing journey. And so God took a small child really to break through his barriers.
Yes. He said he'll do that. He'll use the little children.
Yes. I promised him that I would come and visit him when he got permanently housed to where he was going to be.
Okay.
And so the sentencing was the next week, and he was given a life sentence with a 22-year minimum.
What was his reaction to that?
Well, I have part. He actually reacted numbly.
Okay.
We did a television program on KATU together 2 years later.
Okay.
Where he talks about that.
Okay.
He was pretty numb at that point. I learned later that he was still numb. He had he'd been under a lot of harassment. But he was given a life sentence, and at the sentencing, the victims are allowed to give a victim impact statement. And so I still, you know, praying about forgiveness doesn't mean the consequences are removed.
Right.
And so I asked for the maximum sentence. And I asked that he would be given educational opportunities. And I looked at him. He was very intelligent, did very well in school, was actually categorized as gifted. And so I saw it as another life being wasted. And so I charged him with doing something with himself at some point in time, because he had two lives to make up for.
Yes.
And so that was, you know, a pretty intense day. But it took about 2.5 months or so before he got transferred to where he'd be housed at OSCI. And so then I started, I knew I was going to go down and visit him, but as it got closer and closer to the time, I was, to be quite honest, dreading it. And then just a couple of weeks before I was supposed to start going down, my car engine blew up. And I did not know how we were going to physically get there. So I was praying, okay, God, if you really want us to get there, you're going to have to provide this. I don't have the money to get there. The bus system didn't go out there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the next Sabbath after I started praying for that, the pastor got up at the beginning of the sermon and said, well, folks, we have something unusual that's happened this last week. Mm-hmm. Someone has anonymously donated a car and said that it's supposed to be given to someone who's a member in our congregation.
Oh.
Is there anyone here in need of a car?
Mm.
And that's how I got my car. No. I was able to go down to that first visit.
He said, it's me.
Yes. I was able to say, God didn't just give me a car, God gave us a car. This evolved into a 2.5 year prison ministry time.
Mm.
And during that time, when I first started going down, it was extremely awkward. I was still in very intense grief.
Mm-hmm.
There were some times in those visits where God, he took away that rage so I could have that initial visit.
Mm-hmm.
But there were some times where it would rear its ugly head and I would become overwhelmed right in the visit and not know how I was going to be able to deal with him and have to get up and walk around and pray, and he would be feeling really bad. And so full on, he had to deal with my grief as bad as it was, and which was really a good thing for him. You learn in victim offender mediation. For a couple of years, I was on the board to develop high-risk victim offender mediation training in Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
And experts will tell you that when you go in and visit someone so that they truly see the consequences of their reactions, that's what develops a conscience.
Yeah.
Whereas our traditional justice system,
you just lock them up.
Right, we just lock them up. Mm-hmm. It's completely ineffective. It doesn't work. And people are released very often much worse than when they go in. And so one of my goals was to reach him spiritually,
mm-hmm.
As well as you know that at some point in time he's going to get out.
Mm-hmm.
And so how do I reach him on just a human and emotional level.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it was every week. And it was a very long time sometimes. But we were visiting until after about 2.5 years, he had been completely estranged from his parents.
Mm-hmm.
And we were asked to do a program on the town hall program, and they actually went in and did a prison interview with him at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a pro and con. That program is set up so that the people for, it was at Christmas time, and the program was forgiving criminals.
Mm-hmm.
And so there were a lot of people who are completely against it, not open to it at all. And that's what the program was about. And so the town hall program did an interview with him, and that resulted in him being reunited with his family.
Mm-hmm.
And so that led on to the next journey for him. And to make a long story short, God is really in control of all the details and circumstances. And I had taken out an ad in the LA Times for pen pals for him.
Mm.
And I didn't want him to become institutionalized, and so to have some other contact with the outside world. And there were many people who answered the ad, but one of them in particular, and he would tell me about it when I went down there on visits, the different ones that had answered the ad. Well, one person in particular answered the ad, and this resulted in her starting to go and visit him. And one time when she was going to visit outside of the prison, she was standing in line to go in where he was. It just so happened that she was standing right behind a woman who was visiting her inmate husband, who was like a chaplain.
Mm-hmm.
And so the two of them were Christians, and they just started talking.
Mm-hmm.
And she invited her to sit with them that day, and so the four of them sat together, and that resulted in her conversion.
Mm.
And so I'll never forget the night that she called me. Here's this person that I had never met. She knew that I had taken out the ad that she had answered. And just that Sunday night, I got this phone call from her, and she said, I just wanted to call you, and you'd be the first person to know that I have given my life to Jesus.
Oh,
and it's all
God
because you
that.
Took that ad in the paper.
Oh.
And I had already learned that at the point she saw the ad, she was suicidal. She was in a terrible, violent situation. So God saved her life and brought her to himself, too, as a result of developing this friendship with
Frank. So the offender gave, the offender was able to come to the Lord.
Yes.
And through that, he was able to then share.
Yes.
Out beyond that.
Yes.
Okay, so now where are we at? We have just a minute here to finish up.
Well, what I wanted to say is that all of us have our personal story mm-hmm. to say. And this is taken from God's Amazing Grace. And it says, as witnesses for Christ, we are to tell what we know, what we ourselves have seen and heard and felt. If we have been following Jesus step by step, we shall have something right to the point to tell concerning the way in which he has led us. We can tell how we have tested his promise and found the promise true. We can bear witness to what we have known of the grace of Christ. This is the witness for which our Lord calls, and for want of which the world is perishing. And so each of us have our witness to tell.
Absolutely.
And he gives it to us. It grows more and more if we're walking in tune with the Holy Spirit and letting him lead.
And God does make good on his promise that if we seek his purpose in life, he can make the worst of tragedies into something good. And we won't even know till the kingdom
yes.
what lives have been touched
yes.
and what has evolved since this.
Yes.
We also know that God is faithful in not only, you know, us asking for forgiveness, but him giving it to us when we don't feel like we
yes.
want it. So thank you so much for sharing. This is such an important thing, and we thank you for being willing to share this with us so that we are inspired to do what's right and to follow God all the way.
Thank you.
Viewers, we thank you for being with us, and we want you to join us again next time. But between now and then, take some time out to talk to God. Ask him if there's anyone that you need to forgive in your life. And then ask him to give you the desire to forgive. And I promise you that he is faithful in doing just that.